How did you first have conversations with Sam Altman and Demis of DeepMind? Did they come to you, you go to them?
So we created the letter largely because I knew that many people had concerns that AI could lead to extinction and that we should not just be treating it like every other tech issue, but instead as a global priority. So we created this letter to succinctly convey the shared concern, and then we disseminated it among some profs, and from there it sort of spread organically. And so there were some surprises in that OpenAI signed it, Google DeepMind signed it, Microsoft signed it, as well as many of the scientists that built the current wave of artificial intelligence.
What's interesting is I'm trying to understand also how you were born as a center for AI safety. Are you, were you funded by any of these businesses? What is the ultimate way in which you continue to deliver and do your research?
So we started a while ago, and we're largely funded by a philanthropy. We're not funded by Elon Musk or things like that. So we're just trying to reduce the risks from AI. I've been, as a graduate student at Berkeley, I've been researching safety for a very long time. So this has been a concern that I've had for many years. And now finally, the AI technologies are getting to the point where it's becoming a lot more obvious to the scientific community that this is a large concern. A letter like this probably could not have existed 6 months ago, but given the rapid developments, a lot of people are changing their minds. A lot of experts are changing their minds of just about how severe the risks can be.
Dan, I actually want to go back to Caroline's previous question quickly. Have you taken money from any AI executives that were signatories to that letter, the previous letter, basically key names in the field of AI?
I'd have to check if we're having any funding from any employees that are also concerned about safety. The AI community is particularly large. 90%+ of our funding is from open philanthropy, which is an independent philanthropy.
One question that arose quite quickly when you put out the statement 24 hours ago is the rationale or motivations behind the signatories. Why are they doing this? I get it. There's a long-term broad concern about the risks from AI. But why do you think these leading names who want the field to advance signed the letter that you organized?
Well, so many of them were on the boat of, we got to move as quickly as possible. Developing AI will be a generally good thing. But a lot of the scientists who signed this have recently changed their tune. Jeff Hinton, of course, helps create artificial intelligence, modern artificial intelligence. So did Joshua Bengio. But in recent months, now there's substantially more concern about there being rogue behavior, that these AIs could potentially lead to human extinction as they get more advanced. So for that reason, I think that it's just because people are starting to see that this is moving extremely quickly. We don't understand how these technologies work. It's difficult to steer them. And so that could potentially, they could be misused. Those things could potentially lead to catastrophic risks or potentially in the longer term, extinction.
Very quickly in response to your letter, there were those that note present and much more near term basic risks. Have a listen to Sasha Lucioni of Hugging Face, who joined us yesterday.
I personally see it a bit as a magic trick, as misdirection, right? I care very, very strongly about, for example, data consent, for example, disclosing data sources, disclosing transparency and model documentation. And instead of focusing on that, we're being directed towards these unsolvable risks.
Are we paying enough attention to more near-term and immediate risks from AI?
I should certainly hope that the risk of extinction is not unsolvable, or else we're in big trouble. So I think it's important as a society to manage multiple different risks. I think we can certainly do it. I also think that many of the risks from that currently affect us can take on more extreme forms later on. For instance, if the people developing these AI technologies have decisive control over them, that gives them extremely high power, and power inequality with respect to AI is a concern that could potentially get out of control where a few people are calling the shots in society. So I think that it's important any competent form of risk management will address current ongoing harms as well as tail risks. So I think we need to have a complementary approach.
Yeah, and Dr. Hendrycks, the outcome from this, you've certainly stirred a lot of interest. People perhaps either aligning themselves, thinking that this is too much, or indeed that we need to shine a light on this. How do you think we ultimately take on these risks? You're very good at highlighting what the risks are. Is it regulation? Is it self-regulation? What do you think the outcome will be?
Well, I think that self-regulation would be a useful start, but we wouldn't trust something like a pandemic or nuclear technology just to the scientists. We wouldn't say, solve the AI or the nuclear arms race scientists. It's not necessarily completely their purview. There are technical aspects to this problem, but there are also social aspects to this problem. So we wanted to just make sure that the public is aware that many of the AI scientists, we have AI scientists from all the top universities and many of the people who created it, are concerned that it could even lead to extinction. So then policy tends to be more of a negotiation process. And so hopefully we can get those conversations started, recognizing that there are severe effects on the horizon, such as potentially extinction. So I think we need to treat it as a global priority, and we need to work toward cooperating domestically, but also internationally, so that we're not caught in an AI arms race between different countries. The nuclear arms race brought us to the brink of catastrophe, and we don't want another arms race where we build extremely powerful technologies that could potentially destroy us all, and we just keep stockpiling them. That was not a good outcome for humanity. That could have gone substantially worse. I don't want the same to happen with AI, so hopefully we can cooperate starting today.
Have you seen decent self-regulation thus far on some of the more near-term immediate societal damage we're seeing? As many have referenced, you know, the bias already baked into some of the data that this is being built upon, the worries that the wrong people are being potentially stopped by police, the worries that the wrong misinformation is already circulating. Have you seen that tackled before we even get on to the much larger and more significant concern that you have about extinction?
Yes, I think we ought to be, if we can't address many of those current risks, then I don't have much hope for us addressing some of these larger risks as well. I should say that there's a bit of a mix in whether companies have been successful at making their AI technologies safe. There's some, you know, notable failures, like with Bing's initial rollout where it was threatening users. But some other technologies have been useful in being relatively reliable and mitigating their amount of bias. So there are fortunate signs that there's some progress being made. I'm concerned, though, that since the AI companies are competing with each other, yeah, and are locked in an arms race with each other, that there won't be enough time for safety, that they're going to prioritize development over safety, because if they don't prioritize development and making it as powerful as quickly as possible, then we won't be able to make it safe and bring the risks down to a negligible level.
Is it a risk that by regulating, self-regulating or otherwise, we start to stifle out the new competitors, the smaller players, the academics that you're talking to within labs, rather than the large players such as a Bing or a Bard or an OpenAI?
I think that, if we're concerned about academics, I think that that would largely be the government to be taking care of that. I think that we can definitely target some of these catastrophic risks for models that are at a certain level of capability. That seems like a possible proposal. So we'll basically have to see with these negotiations. I'm largely just pushing for us initiating this process and trying to have broader societal cooperation, including international cooperation on these issues.
Dan, how does the public reconcile that the signatories to your petition, your initiative, were the leaders in the field of AI, the AI evangelists, for want of a better expression, who are now apparently the AI doomers? How have we moved so quickly from leadership to concern in that field?
I think that this is a natural part in any industry, where initially it's move fast and break things, be risk-seeking, tinker, throw stuff at the wall, see what sticks. But then we start shifting over to a more risk-averse regime, where when the technology starts affecting society on a larger scale, now people are actually using these AI technologies, and so we ought to be substantially more cautious with their potential outcomes. As well, it's getting a lot closer to human-level intelligence. So earlier, 2 years ago, they really weren't intelligent at all. But But it's quite conceivable that in the next few years that in many cognitive domains, we have AIs that are as good as us or better. So I think that's one of the main things shifting this underlying change in tone. Because this AI arms race is making it move so quickly, people are starting to think we need to rethink our priorities.